Eduardo, welcome. You are Basque. You live and have the office in Madrid. You have been working all over the world. So, nomad? No dot mat? What's your office?
The office was open in Amsterdam in 1989. Then he moved to Paris, then back to Spain. So, the spirit of the office was moving from place to place and then it became this idea of a nomadic office. So you're moving around and you're designing things in several places. At the same time, no mat, we are not crazy. I was tired, you know, of everybody telling me that our designs were crazy and that were all the things we were doing that were crazy for architecture. So nomad became like this game of words, like moving around, designing things anywhere, and at the same time, we're not crazy. We do different things.
Eduardo, you are the author of some of the, in my point of view, masterpieces of Spanish architecture of the turn of the century. I still remember going to visit the La Cesare Stadium in Baracaldo. Yeah. I remember I called you in the phone and I said, Eduardo, I totally understand that many architects in the country hate your guts because this is so far, but beep, good. This was a very optimistic time that allowed you, us, and a number of others to work. It's a kind of renaissance time of Spanish architecture, and seems like it's gone. Seems like the world has changed in this after this 2008 crisis. What is for you now? What's your next steps? What are you doing?
I think architects reflect society in a way. So society demands things because it's a optimistic time for society. It doesn't have to be an economic optimistic time, just optimistic in terms of looking for new things. So then the architects put all his good work in favor of this pressure of society. When society fails and they stop demanding things from architects, architecture goes down. I think this crisis, which was a world crisis, brought a very pragmatic view on what economy and life should be. And architecture since then has been reflecting that pushing. So what's coming next? I think we're on the point of, in a turning point where a new revolution to bring back beauty will appear. It's not yet here, no, but there's already a feeling between a lot of people dedicated to art and even economy that they are wishing for something else to come back and erase this moment of grayness and dull. No?
You have been teaching at the CHAM, at the School of Architecture of Madrid, for a number of years, other in several other schools. Mm. You are not teaching regularly anymore. How do you see how these new architects are being educated?
Somebody should talk about the work of teachers, of professors. No? They are somewhere hidden, no, in society, like pretending they are not heroes. When I stopped teaching, I realized that I couldn't teach anymore because what I wanted to teach wasn't good for the society I was already seeing that we were transforming into. So I quit. But the teachers that are still teaching architecture in this society we live in now, to me, are really heroes. No? People that are really pretending in a way that what they are teaching is going to be the main work of the students, which I doubt it. So once you have taught somebody to do good architecture, to be worried about the real problems of society and architecture to respond them, you put it out in this society we live in now. And I don't think students have the right tools to confront the pressure of this new social powers or new economical powers. There's a lack of certain education into architectural students to become present in the real world, let's say.
How our students, but also basically any architect, is able or not to position themselves in a longer lineage of an architecture that is a culture.
Yeah.
It's not just the present and the pragmatic answer to a problem. It's long lineages of architects that we belong to those. How do you position yourself?
There has been architects guiding the protection of life through 4,000 or 5,000 years, probably. So it's a very old profession, like the other one, no? So the two main old professions. And it's strange to see that this line, no? This inheritance of the people that worried about beauty becoming part of this way of living, that beauty makes us live better. That's that idea, no? It's something that has been vanishing, no? Towards the 20th century and then the 21st, of course. That's what I was saying before, that I have the feeling that it will come back. Somehow there's a demand of not trained people in architecture, like normal society. There's a demand for appearing something which is different from this dullness, this grayness, no? that is represented by the pragmatic architects. We have to bring back more aesthetics, no? In the term, the antique term, like Greek term of aesthetics, into architecture, and less economy procedures, in a way. No? We have to learn them, but they don't have to be the base of what we're going to do. I don't think this lineage of architects will disappear, but it will come like very thin for a while. Mm-hmm. Very thin. Even some studies are changing of name. No? Some schools are changing architecture into construction engineering. No? So this way to adapt the profession against prejudgments or prejudices of society is something that is, we're living it now. It's something that is happening now. But I think in the future it would be different. At least that's what I'm fighting for. So,
tell me about some of your preoccupations or obsessions. What about precision? You have talked that you have some sickness of precision.
Yeah. I always recommend everybody to read this book by Robert Musil, the Man Without Attributes. There's a chapter in which he talks that all societies would be safe if we create a minister of soul and precision. No? Something I think is one of the most beautiful things that I've ever read. So you create a ministry of soul and precision, which are the two ways to view the world, actually, no? Through your animistic character, no? You read with your sensibility, you read what is in front of you, you understand things. And precision also is like what makes you read it in a very scientific way. So it's linked to reason. One is to the soul and the other one to reason. So when you get them together is when the good things appear. No? It's like there's not only soul and sensibility, there's not only precision and science. No? Both together combined is your getting to a higher point. It's like a good musician, no? He plays with a scientific precision, but at the same time he's playing with the soul. No? So precision is something that everybody should link for. So everybody should have a precise way of talking, precise way of swimming, precise way of eating. No, like doing the best as you can every time of your life. No? Not only by, I don't know, precise way of filming, precise way of, I don't know, interviewing. No, so everything should be like as precise as we can.
And geometry is a big part of that.
Geometry is geometry, the measuring of the world. No, it's geometry makes you be in the space, in the world. It doesn't have to be Euclidean geometry. It's a sense of relating to the space that everybody has without even, it's an intuition. So geometry becomes something that when you enter place, you instantaneously relate to everything. And that's what you have measured, the space by the back of your, it's something like coming from the reptiles, probably from our ancestors. No? You go somewhere and all of a sudden everything is measured. And geometry is so important, I think, is the base of architecture.
Do you excel in your craft, in design and architecture, design in general, we could say probably. What's the value of this, of being a craftsman, someone who just excels?
I want to go, yeah, this is really interesting because I want to go back to the idea of precision. No? Precision is something that we don't see, we don't perceive. It's something that is there, and it conveys a message when you see the whole thing. Without this precision, the whole object or the whole whatever you do becomes like not banal, but more, I don't know, it's like it doesn't give any message. It loses some of its character. So details in precision are something that is hidden in a way, but they've made part of the message of the atmosphere that architecture creates. When these details are, it's like the high precision or high resolution of an image. You don't see the high resolution, but you can perceive it. You know when a picture is printed in 12,000 points or dots per square inch, and you know when a picture is printed in 600. So it's the same picture, but there is something about precision that makes the message and the atmosphere it creates being stronger and cleaner in a way. That's what details does, that's what precision does. You don't see it, but you perceive it.
And you have talked about Brazil, you have talked about, well, you're an avid reader. What are you reading? Can you recommend?
I would say that I like to read books that mix this idea of soul and science. Not science fiction books that I don't like, not regular scientific books that I think they have become a certain religion, a new religion. But I like to read books, for example, of guys that deal with astronomy, and they join and link astronomy with philosophy, which is two worlds that seem very apart, but all of a sudden they link it in a very precise and coherent way. So it really, it's something that I like getting these books, and all of a sudden somebody who's from the world of science becomes to talk and start to talk about the world of soul.
Eduardo, thank you. Thank you for coming to New Orleans and to Tulane and for this conversation.
Yeah, thanks to you, Iñaki.